What's poppin'? It's Enzo McFly. Enzo.
It's comedian Jeff Shelley.
OTG underscore Breezy.
It's Kel in the building.
Boy, yo, Benji.
It's your boy Mikey Iso.
It's your boy
ESG.
What's up, what's up? It's your girl Ingrid here repping Third Ward, H-Town, Parkwood Entertainment, and for the tray. I'm at Cash 22 Radio, and I'm vibing out, man. It's so positive, so much love. Tune in every Sunday at 3 p.m., man.
It's Catch 22 Radio on GMTRadio.com.
Girl, I ain't like to see you like that.
Boy, you better know it. You better have to show off, because we got a special guest in the building, y'all. Uh-huh. Now, the beat that y'all hearing in the background, she actually wrote that song. And it may be something a little similar. You may know what that song is. I think it's number 5. On Lemonade.
Seven.
Number 7 on Lemonade by Beyonce. So our guest today is more than a special guest, okay? She's one of the hottest women out of Houston, Texas. I'm not gonna lie to you.
She got a Wikipedia.
She got Wikipedia, and she got an article on Billboard, okay? So she holds plaques that many only dream of. You know, one that we will get someday. We'll talk about it later. She has written songs for the true queen herself. The true queen of Houston. Beyonce. And with her new project, Where I Stay, she is showing you that she what she is really capable of. She got bars, and we're going to have a freestyle battle in a minute. I'm a battle Ingrid.
Oh, word. I think we should do that.
Now you can use your big words.
Ingrid, don't use your best.
I got you.
Okay, thank you. We got Ingrid in the building. Yeah. I've been waiting on this interview for a long time. I've been waiting for it for a long time. Mind you, my friend that I used to work with, Christina, put me on Ingrid. And she said, bro, I have somebody that you should meet. And I said, who? Ooh. And she said, her name's Ingrid. And it's so like funny. That. She said, just like that.
Ingrid.
And it was so funny because I had just watched Ingrid's Genius interview. And I was like, wait a minute. I said, Ingrid, who? She said, she the writer. Y'all should connect. I was like, you talking like she ain't big. Yeah, you talking like I can just walk up to her and be like, hey, but how you doing, Ingrid?
I can.
I can now.
Yeah, yeah. What's up?
What's going on?
Much. How y'all doing? Y'all
good.
Good. Y'all turned up. I'm like, it's Sunday. I'll be chilling on Sunday.
Oh, I got a few little Sundays. Yeah. This is every single Sunday. Now, you are a rapper. Yes. You're a writer. You do it all, right?
Yep.
So what influences you when you are doing all of these things? What keeps you motivated?
Energy, first and foremost. You know, the energy around me for sure. Life, you know. But yeah, like I was born into music and art. So like, I feel like, you know, everything around me inspires me. So as long as I'm really living, like I'm always inspired. So
right.
Just y'all motivate me right now.
So you gonna write a song about us?
Yeah. Nah. Not that much. Not that much.
I'm gonna be like, Catch 22. I'm gonna be like, I know who that's about. Now you are from Houston, Texas.
Absolutely.
Third Ward.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Now, the city influenced you?
Man, like, tremendously, because I mean, like, the only other place I ever lived besides Houston is Brooklyn, New York.
Mm-hmm.
And I was born and raised in Third Ward. I was born in Park Plaza, as I say in my lyrics. Like, so, like, I've never lived anywhere else. And so, culturally, like, Big Mo was, like, my Luther Vandross, I guess, you know? Like, my parents listened to, of course, real records and stuff like that. But for my generation, how, like, the new generations listen to Drake and Future, like, that's how Big Mo was to me, like, right. During my pivotal and impressionable years, you know? So, like, musically, I learned how to freestyle from listening to Screwtapes, Youngsta, Lil Flip. Like, I envied those guys. I used to wish I could lurk outside of Worthy and stalk Flip, you know, before he dropped out. So, like, so yeah, like, it really, really, really influenced me musically, of course, and personally, like, it's my heart, you know?
That's awesome. So being from Houston, like, actually, I'm gonna go ahead and just get this out the way.
Yeah.
How did you end up meeting Beyonce?
Well, that's a great question. Actually, my mother, God rest her soul, she passed in 93. My mother, Vivian Burley, and Tina Knowles, Beyonce's mom, were friends back in their early 20s. And So literally, like, we were raised together. My parents were friends before I was even born. So my mother was a real estate agent back in the 80s and 90s before she passed away. And long story short, she sold Matthew and Tina their house on Parkwood. She was both Miss Tina's real estate agent and friend. Miss Tina was her hairstylist. And so literally, I was raised in Headliners Hair Salon growing up, and our house was on South McGregor. The Knowles family lived on Parkwood, which is the street behind McGregor. And, you know, so Solange and I were literally raised together, like sisters or whatever. Like, so it's kind of crazy because, like, growing up, I never, ever, ever, even after their success, I never thought, you know, it may be a two-part answer without having a question being posed, but I never thought, you know, to explain further that I would work with them, you know, or work with B, for that matter. Yeah. Especially as she became bigger and bigger, but, you know, the stars aligned, and, you know, I just leave it at that. But, yeah, I've known them since before I even existed because of our mom's relationship.
That's crazy. So how do you get her to... Like, because she's seen you as a little sister, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So how do you say, once she's at this point, like, hey, I can write, and I can really, really, like, write a record. Like, how do you make that transition to not, I'm only your little sister, but I'm just as talented?
Yeah, well, to be honest, I never really had, like, that close relationship with B herself. Because, like I said, like, she was technically kind of like a child star. So her sister was like my sister. And so because of that relationship, the family tie was there. But personally, we didn't really develop our relationship until I moved to New York. She lived in New York as well, and I moved there completely on my own. And to answer your question, she at that point was well aware of my journey because of my relationship with her sister and her family. And, you know, like, I'm like, it's like my extended family, but right. She and I personally, I'd be lying to make it seem like my entire life I've just been around her every day. You know, right. There were years at a time where I didn't necessarily see her, you know what I'm saying? Right. And so I definitely just continued on my path. And when I was living in New York, I was really at the right place at the right time because of our personal opportunity. And she came to me like, yo, I peep, like, I'm well aware, you know, how dope you are, and, you know, you should take a stab at trying to write some stuff, you know, and see where it goes. And I'm eternally grateful for that.
Of course.
Like, I would have never, ever, ever been bold enough to be like, check me out, you know,
like, hey, listen
to my track. Nah, never.
So as a rapper, what made you feel like that you can write, like, her type of music?
Well, before I was signed to Beyonce, I was signed to Music World, which is Beyonce's father, Matthew Knowles' label. He was my first manager, and I was signed to Music World fresh out of high school, really, from 05 to 2010, and I graduated high school in 2005. And so, like, Matthew was really my first mentor, and he really taught me the business and gave me access to his studio 24 hours a day. I had my own code and clicker for the gate, and so, like, that growth was really essential for me. And of course, B at that point was still working with him, and they were still business partners in a sense. So she was always privy to the talent he had around him. And so he really laid that foundation, or helped me lay that foundation first. You know what I'm saying? And as an artist and as a creative, and actually, I don't know if how familiar y'all are with, like, Houston talent that goes kind of back, far back in the day, because there have been some people who have come and gone, but there was a group in the Music World era, like, 10, 12 years ago called Lady Lux. And they were super duper ill, but I actually wrote a lot of records for them. And at the time, like, no one at Music World really knew I was a strong songwriter like that. But that's how they found out, because I started writing records for Lady Lux. And after that, the buzz kind of went around, you know, in the industry, people talking, you know. So yeah. Since then, that's really the first time people learned I could write songs, but people have always known me first as an MC.
That's amazing. Now, speaking of writing, you just received the ASCAP award for your partaking in the joint Shining that we just played. What parts did you write?
The most repetitive part of the song, shine,
the title of the record.
Yeah. It's crazy because, you know, I don't really like, ever since I did that Genius interview for Love Drought, I don't really like breaking down lyrics because it can be a gift or a curse, you know, because people have their own interpretations and stuff. And yeah. And it's for me, like, I just make songs, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, and I'm still like a big kid in that sense. I'm 31, but I'm like, the way I make music is still in a really innocent, non-like process way, you know, it's in a very pre-Instagram way. So I'll just say that, like, when I first started writing for B, I wrote a ton of records. And I wrote a record called Shining when I first started writing for B. And she was able to take that or whomever. I don't even know, you know, at this point, because of how things work, honestly, I don't know how it actually came to form. But I was just thoroughly happy when I got my publishing credits for it. And I knew that I got credit for my work and my idea. And, you know, people try to say that these big time artists steal ideas, and that's actually virtually impossible because, you know, there are laws in place for that. And so, like, I'm living proof that, like, if you have ideas and you're working with the right people, you will be credited for your work.
Right.
And you don't always have to talk about it because sometimes that can ruin the integrity of the record. You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, like, I feel really great about the fact that, like, my ideas are used. And, like, if I submit 30 of them or 40 of them, I know, like, maybe 5 in that 30 or 40 will end up on something, be it a phrase or the most repetitive part,
right,
or the whole song. It doesn't matter, you know what I'm saying? But just the fact that, like, people who are already established and the greatest of the great will, like, use my idea in any way.
I have a question. Mm-hmm. Now, I see how passionate you is about your music career and all that.
Yeah.
So how's your love life?
Man, that's a great question. I can, like, plug myself on here, like Tinder or something. I'm like kind of like, I won't say it sucks, you know. I've definitely, like, fallen in love a few times, but, you know, because of the position I'm in and how private I have to be as a result, I'm really misunderstood, like, on a personal level. So, like, I date, and, like, I like, you know, drug dealer, ex-killer niggas. And so, like, you know, it's the gift and the curse, because honestly, like, the better part of my life, I've only ever focused on, like, music, and I was really awkward at first, and, like, I didn't even really know myself, like, how I know myself now. I lived in New York 5 years, and, like, I really grew up when I lived in New York, and my whole life I've been hit on by both men and women, and it always bothered me because I've only ever been interested in men. But it was like a thing where it's like, damn, like, I'm really different. I rap, I'm awkward. My mom died when I was 6, so I was raised around my dad and my brother. And so, like, being in this industry now, like, it's a time where, like, being gay is cool. So I've even been told, like, literally, I need to attach myself to the LGBTQ community to my benefit. And I think that's awesome, and I support the community, of course, but at the same time, I'm like, I don't want to make a false attachment and be misunderstood, because I'll be single for the rest of my life. It's like MC Light, who went and just married a guy, and then everybody's like her whole career. You know what I'm saying? It's like, and it's just like, at the end of the day, like, I'm a human, so when I go out, like, I want to get hit on by guys, of course. You know what I'm saying? And so, like, to answer your question, I've dated some guys. I've been in love with a couple F boys. I won't say the real phrases. You know, a couple incidents.
Okay, so to certain people, you look like a celebrity, right? So do you think you have to just date celebrities, or you can have a 9-to-5?
I think that's my issue. Okay. People, I don't look at myself like a celebrity. Like, I mean, it's a blessing to be, like, attached to who I'm attached to and everything, but, like, I really, like, live a normal life every day. Like, I'm not gonna put my life on blast because I care about my safety, of course, but, like,
she run every day, though.
I mean, I live a very public life. I'm always by myself. And so I think it's just gonna take a very special man to, like, and a confident man and a secure man to appreciate me, because, like, I know who I am, and, like, B is my manager. She, not my BFF.
Congratulations.
She's my manager. But so, like, realistically, if I attach myself to somebody, my real family is my real family. We kick it under the carport every day in my aunt's crib. That's, like, a normal thing for me. That's my happy space. So if I go get, like, a super celebrity, he's not gonna want to come sit under the carport with me.
No, you know what I'm saying? Like,
you're just gonna get somebody that's really for you.
Well, those, like, the guys who are still street, they like the stripper kind of girls. No disrespect to stripper kind of girls, but that's not me either.
It's all disrespect to them.
You know what I'm saying? Okay. I'm just saying that's not my vibe. So, like, the kind of guys I'm attracted to, that's typically what they go for. Yeah. So that's where I'm kind of caught in the middle, you know?
Right.
And I hate to say
it. So you just need to get you a sweet drug deal.
I'm in your situation right now. I'm not a celebrity, but I'm, you know, I'm very known. And I don't know who I can and can't date.
Yeah.
But I'd rather stay with somebody that's going to love me.
You want somebody genuine. So I'm open. Like, I prefer regular guys on the record. Like, I prefer if a doctor just decided he could deal with a weed.
That's not a regular dude.
Wait,
buddy. My brother, everybody looks like a good guy.
No.
My brother's
a doctor.
My brother's a doctor.
He's not regular. Look, let's let me explain something.
That's not famous.
Look, no. When you say famous, you say regular.
That's what
I'm talking about. So, only 5% of Americans have doctorates. So, therefore, he is in a chosen few.
Well, a lot of my family are regular, I guess.
Yeah.
If I can get somebody to match my family's demographic.
Okay, my family's regular. You said regular. So
you say you don't consider yourself a celebrity. You live an open life.
Yeah.
But you've been in front of thousands and thousands of people when
Absolutely.
You perform with B. So how does that translate in your life? Like, you've been on stage. I watched you.
Yeah.
And I was like, I want to be like her when I grow up. So... So how does that just, like, does it sometimes get tough for you? Like, people see who you are, what it is, you know?
I think that, like, that separates, to answer your question, like, that separates when people can, like, be themselves mm-hmm. and also go on stage and come off stage and still be themselves. That separates, like, people who are born to be performers or superstars, per se, from, like, people who are trying to do that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because most of the time, like, most people, like, weren't born to act like a superstar, if that right. makes sense. You feel me? And it worked. But, like, to go a step further, like, you know, Beyonce is the perfect mentor because she's a close to perfect human. And I'm not saying that from, like, a fan standpoint. I'm saying that from a personal standpoint. Like, she's a solid human. She's a realistic human. So, like, even with all her success, when she comes off stage, she in an Ivy Park sweatsuit, and she goes in her car and she goes to the privacy of her home with her family and her kids. It's not a thousand nannies or whatever. Like, she's a human, you know right. what I'm saying? Like, she's an immensely talented and brilliant human and rich and whatever, you know what I'm saying? But, like, she's still a human. And so, like, people ask me questions about her all the time and they're like, you know, how is it? Like, and I'm like, she's regular.
She's regular.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, that's what keeps me, to answer your question, like, grounded. Like, and that's the reason why, like, I haven't reached anywhere near her success. So if she ain't running around with the whole superstar persona, then I definitely cannot. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
Like,
so you've been around Jay-Z. You ain't come cut his hair yet?
Jay-Z.
Let me watch my... I get that.
Jay-Z is the man of the hour.
But
y'all.
Tell him to cut his hair.
I like it. Black is beautiful. And I would rather a man with a nappy fro than a man with a pressing up. So...
Who's still wearing person goes to
the Cat Williams.
Yeah.
So I think Jay, no shade, but he a comedian, he should be able to take it. But but real life, Jay is cool, and Jay, like, for his age and stuff, he looks so young and fresh. Like, and actually, I will say this about Jay, like, I think that people don't give him enough credit because, like, he may not be as photogenic as his wife, you know, who's like a supermodel, of course, but, like, when you see Jay in person, he's mad fresh. Like, everything about him is cohesive. And you gotta just be realistic. If you walk around next to the baddest person in the world every day, then you look fresh. Like, there's something about you that's fresh.
Yeah,
so
sure.
Trust and believe. His nap. They special. This was special nap. Right?
Yeah. So when you're writing for people, or like when you, or your craft, are you actually doing it? When you're writing songs, are you writing for that specific person, or are you just out there and you're just writing?
Nah, I like that question too. Like, nah, I just do it for me. And that's the thing. Like, I think that, like, if I feel like I paint also, and a lot of people don't know I paint. When I first moved to New York, I sold my paintings to pay my bills, literally. And, like, I used to stay in the Central Park and Union Square, like, in the snow sometimes. And I ain't never been around snow until then. Like, so it was a big learning experience for me. And I was like, all right, this is really humbling. And so once I started making money off songwriting, I have not painted since, y'all. And I got legitimate art collector friends calling me now, like, hey, you been painting? Can we get some art? Well, you come to my crib. My crib decked out with my art. But
how much are you going for?
It could be like $250, $300. Like, yeah, I got some stuff for the low. But most people just talk about it. And if you want it, buy it off my wall. But right. I'm like, I got so much stuff that I never sold from that era. It's like I got PTSD. So it's like now, you know, I decided to keep that more private. So with music and songwriting, like, I don't want it to feel like that, where I feel exhausted, like, I just have to do this to make some money. So the number one thing I make sure I do when I go into create is creating something that I believe in, that's for myself, even if people don't necessarily know, you know, what it's about, so that I, at the end of the day, I really feel good about it.
So just to backtrack, just a little bit, with you being a writer,
and you're writing for women and so people that sing. Mm-hmm. As far as rap goes, how do you feel about that same situation? You know, we talk about ghostwriting a lot. Yeah. That seems to be the downfall of Meek Mill for some odd reason.
Oh, Drake. Yeah.
Well, Drake, excuse me. But I mean, well, no, it was Meek's downfall for saying something about Drake.
Sure.
But I mean, I'm just saying, how do you feel with that same creativity that you bring to the table for somebody like Beyonce or like you wrote for Lady Lux?
Yeah.
How do you feel with that translating over to rap? Is ghostwriting really an issue?
I think so. I think it's a different thing because as an MC and as a rap artist and what hip hop truly started from, it was about freestyling and also constructing raw emotion that like painted, that depicted, you know, your real life. And with R&B and even contemporary jazz and even country, for example, is I listen to a lot of country. That's the perfect genre to use, for example, actually, because other songwriters have been honored in the country community for years. And in that community, you have like typically about 4 to 6 people in the room writing every major country song you hear on a chart. And that's the culture of their business. And everybody in the room gets cut in the same. It's not any messed up controversy at the end of the day, and everyone's credited, and that's the culture. You're just making the perfect records that are relatable and that are top line and that are pop and that can sell.
Yeah.
And I think that when you do it that way, and you make
because they were stupid.
Yeah,
no, I mean, he's smart, but
nah.
He was just feeling himself.
Yeah.
Was it OTV fans?
It's a level, though.
Nah.
Oh, okay,
no. I'm sorry. No. Nah, I would never say, because like I said, I respect everybody, and I be trying really hard because I'm really honest.
Right.
To, like, not say the wrong thing, because in my long, lengthy careers, backfired in my face a few times.
Right.
I'm really a human. At the end of the day, if people that catch me at the gas station just pumping gas for myself, be like, yo, why are you saying something? And I be like, oh. I ain't unarmed, but I will just be like, damn, now I gotta shoot this thing.
So I was trying to look for your music. Is any of it on Apple Music? Where can I find the mixtape? Because I seen that you were posting that certain people were on your mixtape.
Where I stay. Okay, so that's also, I know I keep saying this, but they're really great questions because I haven't been able to address these things. Where I Stay was like a passion project. And my album has been like almost done for a minute. And so basically, we didn't put Where I Stay on streaming platforms because we didn't clear the samples, just to keep it real.
Okay.
And when you don't clear samples and you had a platform that I had to release music, you're susceptible to being sued.
Yeah, for sure.
And of course, nobody would ever sue me because I don't have nothing to sue me for. They gonna sue the next best thing, which is the worst thing for me to happen.
Yeah, right.
So we released it old school style, legally,
yeah.
For free, not reselling anybody else's work. And that's on every mixtape platform. So it's on AudioMac, it's on That Pit. It's on live mixtapes. It's on SoundCloud.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's free.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because like streaming has shifted in the game and just how we take in music so much that it's literally, I'm giving it to people where they can have it and download it without having to buy it.
Right.
And people are like offended, like, but I can't get it on my Apple Music. And I'm like, yo, like, are you can download this and own it. It's yours.
Yeah.
So we eventually, of course, will get the samples cleared when the time is right. But shout out to Slim Thug. Shout out to Cal Wayne, Les, Propane. Those guys, man, they showed up for me like none other. We worked on the record for 5 days straight. I recorded everything in my living room. The beats were made in my living room, co-produced with my engineer. Everything literally was conceived and done within 5 days. My engineer is from New York. Shout out to B. Will. He's actually from Virginia, but he lives in New York. And he had never heard any of the records. We just had an idea, let's do a Texas-themed project. And I played him my favorite artist from Texas, like 15 songs. And I played like 25 Lighters, and I played Selena records. I played some Kanye records. I played some Zydeco records, like some J. Paul. And he tried to start beats on almost all of them, and we just continued to actually make songs for the ones that worked. So the first track, we sampled Selena, I Could Fall in Love. The second track,
that's hard.
We sampled Down South Is Where I Stay by Mr. Man and Slim Thug.
Okay.
The third track, we sampled Destiny's Child, She Can't Love You, from The Writings on the Wall. The fourth track, we sampled Ball and Parlay by Big Pokey. And the fifth track, we sampled Yolanda Adams record. So, it was all my favorite.
Oh, Yolanda Adams record?
Yeah.
Why you guys know that record?
I think I may say damn.
That's Yolanda Adams. That's not Jesus.
Yeah. It was close.
Yeah, I'm a Christian. Really? So I was respectful. Sure, it's a respectful record.
Definitely, definitely. So we're gonna go ahead and get into Rodeo, which is featuring Slim Thug.
Yeah.
That's what Mario, I think that's how you say your name. Mario? Your manager.
Mariel,
yeah.
She's like, Spanish though, Mariel.
Mariel.
Like you can say it.
somebody else. But she was like, you gotta play Rodeo. That's what she told me. So we gonna go ahead and get into Rodeo by Ingrid. It's featuring Slim Thug.
Yeah,
it's Big Thug Money. Let's get it. That Ingrid, I ain't gonna lie to you. I'ma see, now I've been playing Ingrid like for a long time, right? And I used to play Flex a lot. Now you had 7th Streeter on Flex.
Yeah.
Now that's another amazing writer.
Right.
Okay, so I can only imagine what that whole situation was like, but I played it a lot. And every single time I listen to your music, like I feel like a thug. I don't know why. But I just feel real gangster and I wanna fight.
But look, you have to have the mind state to shoot somebody to say you're gonna shoot somebody.
That's true. Sure.
Allegedly.
I got a question for you. What was it like walking on stage the first time in front of thousands and thousands of people? Were you nervous?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I get more anxious than nervous, like, because it's like, I have this jitters, like, just get it over with. Right. And I know I've heard other artists and creators say it before too, but we visualize things in our mind before they happen. So like, if it's being walking across stage to perform or accepting an award or whatever it is, we go over it 1,000 times, like a rehearsal, because that's like how we're used to doing it. So like, I just get to that point where I'm not even nervous, I'm just ready. People ask me like, how you feeling before the show? I'm like, I'm ready, because that energy is so built up, I need to release it. And then afterwards, a lot of times I don't even remember what happened. It's almost like you black out, you know? And unless something is not right, that's when I remember. But if I don't remember, people are coming up to me telling me what happened. And I'm like, dang, like, and then I start getting little flashes of the moments, and I just remember the energy, you know? So it's like, anxiousness, you
and
know?
It's like that every time.
Every time, yeah, every time. It depends on the platform. Like when I was opening for Be On Tour, the only thing on my rider was a bottle of like good bourbon, scotch, and you know I'm really responsible, but. You know, depending on the environment or how I felt that day or what I ate that day for that matter, like I may have one drink before I go on stage just to take the edge off, you know, and it definitely, like, you know, if you drink right before you go on stage and your nerves built with that, one drink, literally one shot, you're like, yeah, I got no peace right now, and I got the mic on my back, and they gotta take the mic out my back. So yeah, that's not a good idea, but the worst thing is I'm falling on stage.
Right.
Yes.
You're
just lucky I wasn't important enough to go viral. On the Formation World Tour, I fell. I think I wasn't in Dusseldorf. I was somewhere in Europe. I can't even remember the city now. I may have been in Dusseldorf. No, those were my in-ears for now. I remember all the bad cities, but I fell bad. Like, I mean, I was walking down. So basically, like, Beyonce has her stage, of course, and then at the time, like, Chloe and Halle were my label mates. We were opening or whatever. And so we had to like walk down like 4 steps to our stage, which is a smaller stage, of course. And so one of the shows, my foot slipped. And I have a fairly like long foot. I wear a women's 10 and a half, 11.
Jesus.
So like, yeah, right. Make fun of me, I don't care.
So you went skiing on the steps.
Exactly. It's exactly what I did. And I skied like, it's exactly what happened. I had my big ass foot slip, and I like, I do really well with falling. Like even the other day I got dizzy on the track and I broke my fall with my hand. Like I don't ever all the way fall. For some
reason.
Just gotta
relax, let it go.
Yeah, and so like I slipped and my butt caught the bottom stair and I sprung up real quick and I cracked a joke on myself in the mic and I just kept performing. And like throughout my set, I did 3 songs on that tour or whatever. I just made reference to it, but in not a pressed way.
Yeah.
And the crowd was just cheering like, afterwards, it wasn't a thing. When I got off stage, all security, everybody was nervous. They're like, are you okay? Like, they were waiting on me. I felt super special coming back. And they're like, are you good?
That video
like,
gonna come back up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I have it on my phone, so I don't care. At least, I'll be like those people who like control their narrative and like, I'll put it out before I let somebody else put it out. No one even knew it happened. So like, no, really, it was funny, but it was a learning experience for me because there was at least like 20 or 30,000 people there already. And that was the very first act in like, and just to recover from that. And then what's crazy is my last big performance here, when I opened for Solange at Super Bowl Live last year, I slipped on stage there. I tripped over the monitor. And I'm not used to floor wedges because I use in-ears, but that show, I had floor wedges and I stepped backwards. And I literally tripped over it. But same thing, no one like booed me. I sprung up and I like played it off. And I think that's the key, you know? Like, yeah, and it's probably on my mind because I just watched Tiana Taylor falling on that tour on TMZ this morning. I saw that clip, but I'm like,
she been having a bad tour. Her weed came on. And she was just like, whatever.
She
yeah.
I'm trying to start. That
wasn't
like a feel. She was like, we finna dance with this.
She fell off stage. She sprung up and kept going, and I didn't really like react like that.
So how hard is it for you to find heels?
Me? Mm-hmm. It's not hard. You just gotta have a bag for all my shoes cost like $700-$800 minimum.
For sure.
It's no under $800 heels in my closet, you know.
But I do that's why she was on a doctor closet. Or something.
Yeah, she got to pay for the
heels. Even my flats, there's no under $1,000 flats in my closet.
Can't afford that.
You talking about regular.
$200-$300.
My sneakers, $200. But, and I'm not saying that to be fancy because I'm fake poor, but at the end of the day, it's quality, you know what I'm saying?
What is fake poor?
Like rich bro.
I live right within my means, you know.
So she got money, she just ain't gonna show y'all that she got money.
I pay my bills on time, you know what I'm saying? But I could go pop bottles, but if I pop bottles out, it would hurt me, and I'm not, you know.
Hey, that's the most real thing I've heard anybody say in the last
3 weeks.
I ain't doing it, you know what I'm saying? Right. So, you know, I like to smoke, so I smoke real good.
Okay.
So that's why I put my money. I don't eat meat. I haven't had red meat in like 14 years. No, I'm not vegan.
Pescatarian,
correct. thank you for saying that correct.
And I wanted to ask this question a while back, but I felt like we were serious, but now we have fun.
Yeah.
What Beyonce smell like?
Yeah, because I want to know that too.
That's so weird. I
really
don't know how I smell weed. I don't know. It's weird. Like rich people. You know, like rich people. Like candles and stuff.
Yeah, I just figured she smelled like shea butter.
Nah. Not shea butter, but like, you know, like honestly, all people who are really successful who care about it, because some rich people, you got some rich people who don't care.
Yeah.
It's another spectrum of rich, you know what I'm saying? But like the normal, regular rich black people, they just like probably smell like their house would smell like rich candles, you know what I'm saying? Or like Tom Ford cologne,
okay,
if she hugged her husband or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like, rich, I don't know. Yeah, like it ain't no like specific. People ask that all the time. I don't know, you know?
So Bella smell like that too?
Khaled looks like he smells like cold cuts.
I can't think about what Khaled is. I don't know. I really don't know what they smell.
Because look, I'm not allowed to cook. When Ingrid gets to this level, you know what I mean?
People say, I smell like Kush.
That's what I'm saying. That's the first time I saw Khaled. I was like,
everybody. People tell you that I smell like Kush.
Yeah.
They say, you got a special smell. I'm like, I know. At the airport, I smell like this.
Khaled bought for me.
Yeah, that's how I smell.
Like, real talk, we got on the elevator. I know China's already just, you know what I'm saying, get down like that. The other two people in the elevator came with me, I know where they was at. I said to myself, hey, this girl smell like weed.
Because he would get my name wrong when he was introducing me. He was like, this is China. China what, boy? China red.
Asia black.
India blue.
What is wrong with you guys for that?
Australia yellow.
What's wrong with you?
Y'all get my name right. Thank you.
Well, we really do appreciate you stopping by.
No, thanks for having me.
Kicking it with us. We had so much fun with you. Like, amazing. I'll be at the show Friday.
Y'all pull up for real.
Yeah, we got a Friday.
We'll be there
Friday. Yeah. I like to.
What show?
Never mind. We'll talk about it.
We'll talk.
Tell me about it.
Yeah. Because Thick and Nasty's going to be on this stage.
Yep.
We're going to be back there. We got our bars ready, you know, so whenever you. Whatever. If you're going to be on the run tour, just let us know like an hour before.
We're going to be on the run. We're going to be slowly walking.
We're going to get there. And where can everybody? somebody find you on social media?
Man, I'm first name basis, thanks to my boss.
Hey,
okay. At Ingrid, I-N-G-R-I-D. That's on Twitter, that's on Instagram, and my SoundCloud page, excuse me, is Damn Ingrid, D-A-M-N-I-N-G-R-I-D. And yeah, man, Facebook, I think it's Damn Ingrid also. And so it's either Ingrid or Damn Ingrid.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anybody ever told you you got like an old British white woman name?
I was actually named after an old Swedish white woman named Ingrid Bergman. My name is Ingrid Bergman. Fast fact. So, yes.
Thanks.
Bougie. Funny. I knew that when I was Googling Ingrid, that white lady popped up. I was like,
I was like, man, I can't find this music on here. What about, I went to YouTube too. White lady popped up on Apple Music. The white lady popped up on YouTube.
That's I'm like, man. Michael said, that's
another singer. Yeah. So then I said, let me try to figure out how can I find her
Black
stuff.
Ingrid. Yeah.
Black Ingrid. You know what? You ever type something like search it on the internet and only white people come up? Yeah. But you're trying to send like a funny picture to your friend, you're like, man, I gotta type black people now.
Thank you again, Ingrid, for stopping by. We're gonna go ahead and go into a mix with DJ Anthrax and the family reunion.
Hey. Who we introduce?
It's Catch 22 Radio Show. Let's get it.
It's Catch 22 Radio every Sunday from 3 to 5 p.m. on GMTRadio.com.